turning the mics on.
Mm-hmm.
That would help.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks, Veronica. Good morning, listeners. It's still 9:30 on Friday, May the 24th. And this is Wairarapa Watch on ROFM 92.7, a programme sponsored by Transit Tours. And you can sign up to their travel club today at www.transittours.co.nz. Transit Tours is all one word, transittours.co.nz. I'm Robin Weaver, and with me is my wife, Val.
Good morning, folks.
And in the studio this morning, we have Adrian.
Good morning, everybody.
Adrian, who is the vet from the South Wairarapa Veterinary Services, right here in the Wairarapa. Good morning, Adrian, and thank you so much for coming today. We realise how busy you are, so we're very privileged to have
good
you
Good morning,
here today.
Val and Rob. Yeah, it's very nice to be invited along. Thank you.
Oh, that's wonderful. Now, tell me, how long have you been a vet?
I've been a veterinarian for 16 years now.
Okay, so what made you want to be a vet?
I didn't want to be an accountant, pretty much.
Oh, that's a Rob was.
No, I'd always been a great fan of animals growing up on the farm here in the in the Wairarapa. So, I left Wairarapa College and went to vet school at Massey and. Yeah, enjoyed myself a little bit too much and missed out on that the first time round. So actually embarked on another on a science degree and another career before coming back to vet school in the late 90s.
Okay. Don't tell me you're an accountant as well.
No, I wasn't an accountant. I did a science degree at Massey after missing the cut at vet school first time round, and then carried on down to Otago, did a postgraduate diploma in wildlife management there, and then worked for ag research for 7 years down at Invermay. I was a technician and latterly research associate with them before yearning to go back to vet school and open up some options. So, yeah, right. I was a late restarter to the vet profession.
Mm-hmm. So you're familiar with wildlife as well as domestic or
agricultural? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so spent a lot of time misnetting birds and banding birds and bleeding birds. And then in my ag research career was actually all about pasture pests, entomology, and then rabbit hemorrhagic virus and a lot of electron microscopy, looking at viruses and insects. Before coming back to vet school, so I've had a varied approach, mm-hmm. but it's all been
a fascinating,
rewarding,
fascinating one.
Absolutely,
yeah.
So,
good idea.
There's banks of knowledge that rarely get used anymore, but I appreciate the opportunities that I've had in the past, and yeah, it's good.
And you can look at a situation and say, oh, that's that beetle.
Yeah, not as common these days, but yeah, I've spent my time on the end of a spade in Southland and Otago, that's for sure.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, lovely. Great.
So now you're in a nice, shiny property there on the main highway,
yeah.
And it's looking fabulous from the outside. How's it all going?
It's fantastic. Mm. So you're referring to our new clinic in Carterton, which is our sort of like our main hospital. That is much better than our previous one, which, mm-hmm. to be honest, if it was a horse, would have been taken out and shot quite a few years, beforehand. There was quite a journey to get there, but now we're in, it's absolutely fantastic. Yeah.
So what facilities are there? Do you have cattery and kennels?
No. Well, we do for our inpatients, but mm-hmm. we don't specifically do animal boarding.
Okay.
But yeah, we've got a great kennel and cattery for the inpatients and inpatient care. There's a couple of surgeries. A treatment room, imaging, some consult rooms. Yeah, it's fantastic for the staff compared to what we've had to work in previously.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right. Yeah. And how many staff do you have there?
Across the whole business, there's 20 veterinarians now. And 50 staff in total.
Is that right?
That's on the three locations.
That's on the four locations.
Four locations.
So there's So we opened the Masterton Clinic close to 5 years ago now.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so Masterton, Carterton, Featherston and Martinborough. Yeah.
That's good coverage.
It's great coverage for the Wairarapa population, certainly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So you have vets that go out in the field and deal with...
You talk about a shiny new office. Well, for six of us, well, actually more than six of us, eight of us, nine of us, our office is actually our vehicles.
Okay.
So we restock and do paperwork at the office, but most of the time we're out on the road. Seeing people and animals at their places, whether it's a horse or a production animal.
Mm. So what radius do you cover?
For the most part, we go from close to Mount Bruce right down into the Hutt Valley, or the Upper Hutt area, right down to Palliser and out to the coast.
It's quite a big area.
It's a really big area, which creates it's a challenge to cover after hours or for those obligations. So, especially if you're the one on, so if you're the one vet doing the after hours work.
You get a call from Palliser and then a call from Mount Bruce.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. You just never know.
Need a helicopter.
Oh, yeah, I wish. it'd certainly be a time saver, that's for sure.
Mm. Yeah.
Do you look after the creatures at Pukaha as well?
They have access. So, they've got a really good team there.
Yeah.
They have access to Wild Base at Massey, which for them is only less than half an hour away.
Because it's down the other side of the hill. Yeah.
We do some helping out with some supplies and some imaging studies. So, we have mobile X-rays. So if they're worried about, in particular, it's been tuataras and kiwis wondering what's going on with the eggs and chick positioning. So the ability to snap off a quick X-ray and check that everything's all right is convenient for them. Yeah, it's good.
Brilliant.
Makes a nice change for us too.
Mm. Gets you back to your wildlife roots.
Yeah, just a wee bit. I try not to let on too much about that though.
Sorry folks, you didn't hear that.
Yeah.
Now, do you have veterinary students coming to do training?
Yeah, we do. So there's as part of the training, there's an in-practice component, which they're obliged to do. So, yeah, we have a steady stream of young veterinarians, or young or not so young veterinarians, coming through as part of their training. And not only veterinarians, vet nurses as well. We quite often have them on placement in the clinic. So that's nice to see. Everybody gets invigorated by fresh, keen people who are eager to learn. That's great for all of us.
Yeah.
So the vet nurses sort of assist in the theatres and the
absolutely, yeah, the they're a really room. Critical part of business now, because there's they're really quite skilled, trained paraprofessionals that can do a lot in the back room.
Mm. Well, I have to say, even your front of house people are fairly professional. And
We're blessed with a very good team of people.
You are,
yeah. And the students that come through, are they from a vast range of backgrounds, of town as well as country?
Absolutely,
people?
Yep. So we have veterinarians, we've had vet students from the UK coming out as well, who just want to have a bit of a change of scene.
Okay.
We get all sorts and it's great.
So can they come out on like a two-year working visa or something like that?
Quite often for those students coming out, it's just a few breaks over the equivalent of their summer holidays.
Okay.
But we currently have a veterinarian couple from the UK who have come out for a year. They're doing, one of them is locuming. The other is doing a maternity leave cover for one of our team while they have a baby. And we've got another English graduate, a Canadian, and an Irish graduate as well.
Oh, that's really great, isn't so it? Because they've all got their stories to tell too.
It's
from
really
where they're
good.
From.
It really makes the workplace quite interesting, and mm-hmm. The great thing about a multinational workforce, I guess, is that there's multiple approaches or we're all learning from each other.
Mm-hmm.
So it's great. Mm. The animals are the same worldwide, but the approach to treatment.
Yeah.
Sort of the techniques and, as you say, the holistic approach.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. We can all learn a lot from each other. Of course. That's great.
Yeah. Brilliant. So how long does it take to get a degree if you wanted to be a veterinarian?
Okay, so the vet science degree at Massey is a 5-year degree. Mm. It's the only university in New Zealand that offers a degree. And it's a name described as veterinary science. It's a, mm-hmm. it's really strongly focused on the scientific aspects of the veterinary profession, which gives everybody a really good grounding in practice. So, yeah, it's a great degree. There's Massey trained veterinarians not only all through New Zealand but also overseas. Practicing overseas as well. It has the accreditation from the American Veterinary School or Veterinary Association, which means that there's very few hoops for us to go and practice in North America. Right. We're registered by, recognised rather, by the UK, so it was easy for, it is easy for a lot of us to go and practice and work in the
UK. That's brilliant, isn't it?
Yeah, it certainly helps develop one's clinical skill by spending some time working overseas.
So is it am I right in saying that a veterinary degree is longer to it takes longer than a doctor's degree?
No, it doesn't. The medical degree, my understanding is that there's a 6 years in the training phase plus a registrar period where they have to spend time. So no. I
was told wrong then. I'd
venture to say that the medical profession have it a little bit harder than us, primarily because they have to deal with humans as the patients.
Right.
Who are inclined to talk back.
Well, human. Wouldn't it be nice? We can't ask our patients what their symptoms are.
Mm.
So we don't work with what we symptoms. We work with what we call clinical signs. So that would be temperature, heart rate, the findings of a physical exam or a visual exam.
Mm.
Whereas for the most part, human clinicians are able to ask their patients, you know, where does it hurt? What are you experiencing? And that can help them a lot. In our case, we're dealing with multiple species that cannot tell us. So we have to use a lot of different techniques to try and make our best guess. Virtually.
So what makes a good vet?
Good, great question.
I'll leave the room.
It's pretty simple, really. I think if you graduate from any of the recognised veterinary schools and get registration in New Zealand, your academic knowledge is as good as it's going to get.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I think the most important thing about being a veterinarian, or what makes a great vet, is the ability to communicate really well with people. The animals are one thing, but actually it's the human animal relationship that you're dealing with in the most part, that ability to deal with the client is probably paramount more than anything. Whether it's a farm situation or somebody's beloved pet, that ability to effectively communicate with people is important. Yeah. This is not a job where you're closeted away with just you and the animal.
Mm-hmm.
You need to be able to respect the relationships between animals and people.
Empathy's number one.
Empathy's good, but it can be damaging if you have it in spades.
Yes.
Because then you end up carrying around a lot of a lot of issues that means that it's pretty hard to function from one call to the next.
So. Yeah.
So yeah.
Empathy, but pragmatic with it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Tempered with a bit of pragmatism.
Yeah, pragmatism is critical, I think. Yeah, otherwise, yes. Otherwise you'd fall to pieces in a gibbering wreck pretty quickly.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So what are the health issues with farm animals that you're dealing with right now?
Oh, crikey. At the moment, on dairy farms, for instance, in cattle in New Zealand, nationally, we're dealing with the mycoplasma outbreak.
Mm-hmm.
We've been very fortunate in the Wairarapa that that the impact has been limited. It doesn't, of course, devalue the stress that a few people have been through here with that. So that's definitely a watching brief. Currently, it's the autumn. We're about to head into winter.
Mm-hmm.
So for dairy farmers, it's for the most part nearing the end of lactation for the cows. So mm-hmm. people and cows are very tired, a little bit over it.
Mm-hmm.
So our teams are busy with drying off cows and putting teat seal into heifers and lepto vaccinations. On the dry stock blocks, sheep and beef blocks, it's tail end of the primary parasite season and getting animals set up for the winter and lambing,
mm-hmm.
which will be coming up shortly. Overall disease issues, I guess, is that ongoing focus on health and welfare and sustainable production. I think we've probably made huge strides over the last 20 years in animal health to the point that herds and flocks are much healthier than they've ever been before. And a lot of new techniques and approaches, very much a preventive health focus, has helped a lot. We now, for instance, in the Wairarapa, we're probably treating 5,000 less cases of mastitis in lactating dairy cows than we've ever treated before.
Well, that's good, isn't it? That's excellent. Yeah.
So it's barriers at the top of the cliff rather than picking up the pieces at the bottom.
How about the facial eczema?
Yeah, we've had a pretty rough year this year. I think it's something that I guess whether or not you believe in climate change or the effects of climate change, I think we're going to see a lot more facial eczema year on year.
What conditions are help facial eczema exist?
Yeah, so facial eczema is caused by a set of fungal spores.
Oh, it's a fungus, right.
Yeah. And the disease is actually the end of a very long chain. So the animal eats these spores when they're eating grass. These spores coat the grass and the material that the animal's eating, and then they damage the liver. And then if the liver's damaged, then it actually can affect a whole range of function in the animal. And then chemicals that would normally be filtered out by the liver are actually into the bloodstream, and they react with sunlight. So hence the facial eczema that we see on thin areas or white areas of skin that can get access to the sunlight. So these chemicals make it to the skin surface. They react with sunlight in a totally inappropriate place. They probably should have been reacting with sunlight in the grass. Of course, that chemical reaction causes tissue damage. The animal's own immune system responds and you end up with a nasty sort of cascade.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's almost like sunburn on steroids.
Right.
These poor animals. So yeah, we're warm nights, a bit of high humidity, and with a bit of leaf litter for this fungus to grow on. Creates perfect environment. So generally, as soon as you start seeing mushrooms, you know that spores are going to be growing.
Okay.
So often if you've had a really good growth during the summer,
yep,
and farmers have either topped paddocks or there's quite a litter bed, dead leaf matter built up in the pasture,
right,
that's a perfect substrate for this fungus to grow, you know, in later January or February if we get moisture.
So that's why trees are not all that popular in some places.
No. So, yeah, south-facing slopes or paddocks with shelter belts can create environments where there's not a lot of sunlight and or things just don't get the opportunity to dry up that much.
So you got the spores.
A traditional Wairarapa hot, dry summer is perfect. Keeps a lid on that sort of thing. But we've had the occasional rainfall and humid days.
We have.
And that can really foul things up.
Mm.
Yeah.
And that's why the warning level is at blue at the moment, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, that's now that we've had some frost, those spore counts will come down rapidly, but the damage has been done.
Oh, okay.
So there's no way that the farmer can deal with the soil that is causing that.
No, not really. So before spore levels build up, you can use fungicide sprays to reduce the number of spore-producing fungi, and you can. The alternative is you can put preventive things in place for the animal directly. So, zinc. For a variety of reasons is quite protective. So oral zinc, whether that's a long-acting bolus into their stomach, into their rumen in these cases, or high levels of zinc in their daily feed or water can help reduce the effects of the toxin in the liver.
Interesting.
But the sun is a, you know, it's cruel, isn't it? I mean, and it's getting worse, isn't it? With the horses, for instance, we just drive along and we see, you know, the horses with the coats on. And we say, oh, gosh, it's so hot. Why have they got those on? But it's because of that very reason, isn't it?
Well, that to some degree, but it also, you know, a bay horse on a hot day is exposed to a heck of a lot of you know, radiant heat from the sun. They're a lot more comfortable with a light summer cover on.
Okay, so the majority of domestic animals, they're chipped. Is that about the case now for most of the animals that come through?
Dogs have to be for their registration, apart from working dogs or certified working dogs. So most domestic dogs, that are certainly if they're registered, they have to be chipped as part of that. There's certainly limited numbers of cats that are microchipped. Certainly, I'm a strong advocate for microchipping animals because it's usually our first step when we get an animal either lost or alive handed to us, or tragically, if somebody brings a hit by car animal that's dead, we can actually scan that. Find the microchip number, and then if that chip is actually registered on the national database, we can actually ring them and the database with the number and get the client's details, and then that enables us to make the sad phone call. It means that people actually know what's happened. And if we've got a live healthy, happy animal, we can reunite them with their owner quickly. It's great.
Oh, that's good. Now, how about with sheepdogs? Are they still treated for hydatids?
So, hydatids is an interesting one. We we have pretty much, I'm not sure of the official status, but I'm pretty sure that it's if not officially eradicated from New Zealand, is no longer an issue. Of course, hydatids is not only a animal health issue, but also an export, but also a human health issue. So it was really important to get rid of hydatids.
So what would happen in human form then?
Yeah, well, you could end up with hydatid cysts all through your body, which require surgical removal, which is quite nasty. So there's a lot of impetus for getting rid of hydatids. I guess hydatids is one of those great examples of a zoonosis, which is a disease that's shared by both animals and people. While the definitive life cycle was through dogs, it could have quite nasty effects on people.
Indeed.
So,
yeah.
So removing it from New Zealand's dog population was definitely a focus through the 60s and 70s.
Yes. Exactly. Yeah, when we first came here in the 70s, it was like major,
yeah.
major issue.
All dogs had to be dosed and
yeah.
had
every
to,
six weeks. Yeah.
And certainly they're sort of disappearing, but there used to be dog dosing strips.
Yes,
right. On the side of rural roads,
yes,
where dogs would be brought along, dosed, and samples of their feces were taken to verify mm-hmm. that they weren't shedding hydatid's eggs.
Mm.
Right.
From the hydatid tapeworm. So yeah, that's a part of New Zealand that's all but disappeared.
That's incredible then, isn't that? That's a really good step forward, isn't it then?
Absolutely. I guess it's an example of, we're dealing with Mycoplasma bovis now, but it's an example of the New Zealand veterinary profession actually leading disease eradication.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I guess somebody asked me, it was actually at a primary school talk recently, what is it that veterinarians do? And it actually made me think quite a lot, question my life choices. To some degree, but actually we as veterinarians are actually trained to very quickly recognize the abnormal.
Uh-huh.
So from a disease point of view, we're entrusted with being the eyes and ears
mm-hmm.
For disease surveillance in New Zealand, and being able to even just be driving down the road and recognize something that's not normal is critically important.
Mm-hmm.
So although we've nearly, I assume, not exactly eradicated hydatids, it would be fatal to take our foot off the gas right now, wouldn't it?
Well, it's something that's really important. I guess there's an aligned tapeworm disease, sheep measles. So sheep measles is still an ongoing problem not from a human health point of view, but certainly from a an export point of view.
Right.
So the cysts from this particular tapeworm can cause damaging lesions on sheep meat.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That can be quite hidden. So it's really important that anybody that's got dogs in the rural environment is dosing those dogs for tapeworms on a regular basis.
So how often should they be dosed, Adrian?
Ideally monthly.
Right, every 4 weeks.
Mm. Yeah, certainly with a tapewormer. The problem is with a lot of these tapeworm eggs, they're actually spread like dust. So they live, they're very highly encased, and they can, the dried out dog feces, if it's allowed to be wind blown, you know, these eggs can spread for a very long way.
Mm.
So there's been ongoing focus on people who are visiting farms, duck shooters, for instance, that their dogs are actually dosed before they go out into the environment. But I'd argue that certainly that anybody who owns a dog should really be incorporating a tapewormer. Mm-hmm. Certainly urban dogs, 3 monthly, if they're dosed with a tapewormer, that will really help, because there's nothing more upsetting than having a farmer than having a line of lambs come back mm-hmm. with a notification that that a significant proportion of those lambs are showing lesions.
Mm.
That's going to be devastating.
Well, especially if you've done your work on dosing your dogs
mm-hmm.
and knowing that there's this wind-blowing dust coming in, or somebody's come in onto the farm with an undosed dog and it's just created a real problem.
So all rural dogs should be dosed every 4 weeks?
So
whether or not they're involved with sheep.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So even the household pet.
Yeah.
And part of that is breaking the cycle too. So making sure that that they're only fed commercial food, or that if they are being fed offal, that offal is treated, that is boiled,
yeah.
or heated. So it's cooked offal.
Mm-hmm.
And limiting scavenging. So if certainly picking up carcasses and burning or burying,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
Images of foot rot flaps come to mind.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, and these are ongoing challenges for us. absolutely. Yeah. So we run a national, what's called the national dog grooming program. So our farmers can subscribe to that, and that means that their tablets get sent out to them
automatically
monthly. They just enroll their dogs, and that's open to all our clients. So not necessarily a rural dog,
any dog owner,
any dog owner. So they can just have the tablets arrive in their mailbox.
So that's right from the little Bichon Frise right up to the
absolutely, it's the same pricing whether you buy the pills in the clinic or get them through the mail.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we don't want to create any impediment to anybody dosing their dog.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right. So all dog owners, listen up.
Exactly.
You need to dose your dogs against sheep measles.
Yes.
Well, I think we'll give Adrian a wee bit of a break now so he can have a drink of water because he's been talking for so
only
long.
Water.
And we're
yes.
going to play a piece of music for the break. And what have we chosen, Rob?
We've chosen, believe it or not, we're going to play by Frankie Lane, Rawhide.
Rawhide. We're going to play that for you.
Rawhide.
And we'll be back soon, folks.
We will.
I'll go and get you some more water.
Lovely. Thank you.
Rolling, 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 rawhide. Ha! Ha!
Keep rolling, 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 oh, the streams are swollen. Keep them doggies rolling, rawhide. Through rain and wind and weather, hell bent for leather, wishing my gal was by my side. All the things I'm missing, good victuals, love and kissing, I waited at the end of my ride. Ooh, I might hit him up in, might hit him up raw high. Cut him out, ride him in, cut him out, ride him in raw high. Ha! Ha! Keep moving, 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 though they disapprove. He's moving rawhide. Don't try to understand him, just rope and throw and brand him. Soon we'll be living high and wide. My heart's calculating, my true love will be waiting, waiting at the end of my ride. Move him out, hit him up, hit him up, move him out, hit him up, rawhide. Cut him out, ride him in, cut him out, ride him in, rawhide.
There you go, Frankie Lane and Rawhide, just for Adrian. Did you enjoy that, Adrian?
I did, actually. I haven't heard that for a long time.
A long time.
You're back with, it's now 10:03 on Friday the 24th of May, and this is Wairarapa Watch on RFM 92.7, a programme sponsored by Transit Tours, who are recommending that you get off the beaten track and explore the country. And you can find out how on www.transittours, that's all one word with a Z in it, transit.co.nz. My name is Robin Weaver, and with me is my wife Val, and in the studio today we've got Adrian, who's been telling us all about his experience as a veterinarian.
Oh, and a fascinating subject too, Adrian. It's been really interesting listening to you. So we'll carry on with the questions we've got here for you. And what are some of the difficulties the practice faces on a day-to-day basis?
Oh, crikey. How long's a piece of string?
Oh, you and I could go for a coffee break
now. Yeah. I guess the profession faces a few challenges.
Mm-hmm.
Arguably, there's recruitment and retention. So it's actually very hard to find good veterinarians and retain them. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of challenges working as a veterinarian. There's high levels of stress. Not only dealing with the patients, but actually dealing with all the ancillary things that go with the patients. Mm-hmm. So arguably, from my point of view, our biggest challenge in the day-to-day running of the business is actually dealing with the emotional aspects that a lot of our people are having to deal with.
Mm.
It's not... our fault, and it's certainly not the people's fault that their animals, beloved animals, suffered an accident or illness.
Mm-hmm.
But dealing with the consequences of that can be really tricky. For many people, they their last visit with an animal to a veterinarian may have been 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And a lot has changed in those 10 years, including, unfortunately, the cost of getting veterinary attention. And that can be quite, so a lot of people experience quite sudden and sticker shock, for want of a better description.
Yeah.
And that's really challenging. We understand that there's a range of people in the community, and some can pay and some can't.
Mm-hmm.
And trying to tailor the care, the best care that we can for that animal and that client can make it very hard.
It's a huge challenge.
Absolutely. And we really feel for not only the animal but also for the people trying to make it fit it all together. And when you realise that by treating or going down a treatment path for this animal that maybe kids aren't going to have shoes or aren't going to have anything to eat or... That's a pretty tough ask on the veterinarians and clinical teams involved. There is no denying that prices have gone up and have to go up, and they have done for everything. Yeah.
But are they able to pay like so much a month or something?
So we're quite happy to do. So there's multiple options. We can there's instant finance options.
Okay.
We can arrange reasonable terms in advance for people. So it's just the main thing is actually having a conversation early. Absolutely. So our clinicians are trying really hard, and we just ask people to don't be scared to talk about money with us. If we can try and tailor care to people's budget, certainly.
Yeah. And people, maybe a good idea for them to have animal insurance too.
Yep. Yeah.
So that would always help.
So pet insurance helps for certainly those accident illness things. Most people are, I think, market for pet insurance in New Zealand is probably only about 5%, if that. Whereas in the UK, it's getting pretty close to 30% now.
Yeah.
So there's quite a difference there. Yeah. Most people elect to self-insure, but they should really be aware that things go up.
Yes.
And if your reference point is 10 years previous, where Fluffy had a broken leg, if Boris presents with a broken leg 10 years later, ouch. And it could be a totally different fracture and set of circumstances with a different veterinarian. Have those conversations early. We're trying to.
Absolutely.
And look after your animals.
You can't necessarily avoid that accident or illness thing.
No.
That's where insurance helps a lot. We're aiming to be extremely proactive with that health checkup thing. Don't get surprised by a diagnosis of something that could have been picked up or diagnosed years earlier. That's always a bit hard too.
Until the owner realises that there are symptoms here that isn't normal.
That's exactly right.
And we're
right.
Already years down the track.
Years down the track.
Yeah.
It gets pretty tough.
So arthritis is typical in some dogs, isn't it?
So arthritis in dogs and cats.
Don't they? Labradors really seem to suffer from it.
Yeah, not only that, but there's also breed issues. Not only are some larger dog breeds prone to what's called hip dysplasia. So in other words, their genetics predispose them to having very shallow hip sockets that really can't stand the weight of the animal. Right through, there's a big push, the pushed in face dogs, the pugs and the French bulldogs and the English bulldogs. I mean, that's a breeding issue that creates a raft of respiratory disease and concerns. that that's something that we're certainly focusing on. Now there's tail docking, which is gone now, which is fantastic. All dogs deserve to have a tail.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's part of the steering gear.
Yes. Not only that, but it's how they express things to other dogs. I think we're making quite good progress through that.
Stopping that practice.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
There are so many different breeds of dogs now, isn't there? There's also, I mean, if you crossed your dogs when we were kids, a dog would be crossed. They're just a mongrel.
Yeah.
Whereas and now you pay like $1,000 for a hoodie poodle or whatever.
And those crossbreeds are very healthy animals generally, because they have full hybrid vigour expressed. Mm-hmm. So we don't see a lot of those purebred genetic problems and a lovely crossbred dog. Mm-hmm. So certainly if you're looking for a dog, please consider first of all local shelters or SPCA.
Absolutely.
And before you go necessarily shopping for a puppy, a purebred. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You walk into the SPCA and some of those animals, they just look so bright and ready to go.
They're gorgeous. Yeah, absolutely.
You wonder why they're there in the first place.
Yeah. Well, they've got their
circumstances.
Yeah.
And they can vary. Yeah, certainly.
And it does cost to maintain a dog. I mean, you've got to feed it.
Yep.
Treat
and you have
it every
to know that
weeks.
Right from the beginning. You know, when you give a little child a dog, they've got to.
Oh, it's a lifetime. It's a pet's lifetime. Absolutely.
It's a responsibility, isn't it?
Yeah, and pet ownership is a privilege, not a right. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So, we're privileged to be able to give them a home for life, and that's what we should be aiming towards.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what's the fun part of your job then, Adrian? There must be some fun.
Looking for the fun in your daily grind.
Yeah.
In fact, it's quite. I think for me personally, it's quite easy. I get. I'm in the privileged position of not only going to work and seeing my friends at work, but also long-standing relationships with my clients, which means that I, for a large part of the year, tiki-tour around and chat with my friends.
Mm-hmm.
And that's my job.
I love it.
And occasionally I get to pull on a glove and put my arm inside a cow or two or 100 or whatever.
And see new life.
Not only that, our farmers are a lot more skilled at obstetrics than they ever used to be.
Mm-hmm.
So we get the challenging obstetrics cases, which means that there's not always a happy outcome.
Yeah.
But yes, those live carvings or live lambings, they're brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
There's lots of really satisfying aspects to the job.
Mm-hmm.
There's lots of things that don't go so well. But somebody very wise once told me that you shouldn't work with animals or children. And I've probably failed in both.
Says on just about every product, keep away from children.
So I love my job. I think we've got a really good team of people.
Mm-hmm.
We often have, even in the trying times, have a bit of a laugh and have some fun.
Mm-hmm.
And I think basically in the Wairarapa you've got a good group of animal owners as well.
Certainly,
Farmers.
We have our share of welfare cases, but I certainly wouldn't say that we rank that highly.
No.
I'd like to think that our business is quite good at proactively heading things off before they reach the attention of any sort of regulatory group that we can actually help people steer them out of trouble before.
And the general public now look at animals in a field as they go by and they don't, and they're liable to report it now, whereas before weren't. They'd mind their own business and carry on.
Agreed. I think that we all have a responsibility and recognise that responsibility to the animals in our care. I think some of the most distressing things that I see are actually when clients themselves, farmers themselves, recognise that their animals are under pressure. and that they feel that pressure themselves. They take that.
And they
on
go
board.
Into depression.
Well, that's a challenge, especially during the drought seasons and particularly with weather events, and that's challenging for everybody. And I think now we understand a lot more about that, and that we can try and help as much as we can.
So it's not only the animals; it's the mental health of the farmers themselves.
Absolutely. Almost without exception, all of my clients, everybody's uncomfortable. Everybody can recognise the signs of distress or pain in an animal, and that makes us all very uncomfortable, and it's stressful.
Mm-hmm. So they'd be very glad to see you every so often, come to have a chat and have a...
Yeah.
Even if they're not there for any official call.
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, good on you. I like that idea.
So tell me, Adrian, how do you keep up with the new technologies that are around? Because you're not in the classroom anymore.
Yeah. So actually, our industry, we've got a mandated what's called CPD or continuing professional development.
Okay.
So actually this week in Wellington is the New Zealand Veterinary Association mega conference. There's a whole lot of veterinarians from around the country down on the waterfront at Wellington right now. We are mandated to, over a 3-year rolling average, collect a certain number of CPD points to maintain our registration. So in other words, you can't come out of vet school and then lock yourself in and not update yourself. Otherwise, you lose your registration.
Of course.
So that's an ongoing aspect for the profession. So it also gives the public some surety in that when they see a veterinarian, that person is to maintain their registration, they've had to keep up to speed. Now, having said that, I don't believe necessarily that any single veterinarian has enough knowledge to be able to cover all the width and breadth of knowledge in animal care now. So, in our business, we have production animal veterinarians, equine veterinarians, and companion animal veterinarians, and we have a few mixed practice veterinarians that do either equine and companion or large animal and companion. But we don't have many veterinarians that would be able to be comfortable to give great service to across the entire range. The breadth of knowledge and the techniques are just too wide. Yeah.
Do you get the odd birds come in with broken wings?
Yeah, we do. Some of them have responded brilliantly. We had a duck with a broken wing that was actually pinned up with an external fixator, and that duck's gone really well. It was just one of those fortuitous coming together of a vet with the right attitude or wanting to give this a go, and the presentation of the duck, and that worked out really well. We have great support from Doc for injured native birds, native lizards. In most cases, though, there's not too much we can do by the time that the wild animal's captured. A lot of young birds found on the ground should usually just be left where they are. Quite often, especially blackbirds and thrushes, they'll actually fledge out of the nest and then follow mum around for a while. So in most cases, they should just be left where they are. Ducklings, to some degree, in the same way, they're not fed milk or anything like that. They're able to forage themselves appropriately. So it's always that balancing act.
Okay, so finally, I always ask you, should any listeners be considering becoming a vet, what skills would you say are critical for the job?
The selection to vet school is primarily focused around academic ability, although there is an interview component now, which is great. And that recognises the fact that communication is the most critical component of a veterinarian's life. Not only we can't necessarily communicate with the animal, we've got to be technically competent that we can assess what's going on with the animal.
Mm-hmm.
But it's that relationship and that communication between the client and the veterinarian that's critical. I think there's no doubt that our technical training is excellent, and that all of our graduates can do what they need to do technically. The veterinarians that really shine are those veterinarians that are able to communicate really well with people.
Right.
So that well-grounded person who's quite balanced, and is able to cope with a variety of situations, has some common sense, and is able to communicate with a wide range of people, they're people that that should consider becoming a veterinarian, certainly.
Brilliant. And it's a wonderful job, and you do an amazing job. And we thank you very much for coming along today and talking to us. It's been most interesting.
It has. It's been fascinating. Thank you, Adrian.
No problem. Thank you very much for having me in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So all we have to do now is just
we've got a couple of items
here.
Yes, and here's the first one. Mathscraft is coming to Martinborough. And Mathscraft is, I'll just find the core bit I'm looking for, is special because it's the first regional event of this nature, and
it
features a range of hand-on craft stations where participants are encouraged to try a craft and learn something about the mathematics behind it, i.e. you don't have to know calculus or advanced algebra or anything like that, but just to understand what's going on behind what you're doing. So if you're throwing a pot, what's actually happening mathematically on the wheel?
And it's going to be at Martinborough.
It's going to be at Martinborough Town Hall. So that'll be one of the first events down there, I would think. It's a new one, isn't it? On Sunday, May the 26th, so that's day after tomorrow, in the Martinborough Town Hall. And it's from, do I see any hours here? No, but if you go to the website, www.mathscraftnz.org, mathscraftnz is all one word, www.mathscraftnz.org, and then it's, yes, well, and the people you're looking for are Jane Mark or, I just saw her name, Dr. Jeanette McLeod. Those two people would be happy to talk to you about Mathscraft in Martinborough on Sunday, and I would imagine it starts about 10 o'clock. I guess. I don't know for sure. So you need to go on the website and find out. And All Is True, the world's final act of the greatest playwright. All about Shakespeare. And he returns home to Stratford with his wife Anne Hathaway. And in 1613, when the Globe Theatre burned down during a performance of Henry VIII, and Shakespeare returns to Stratford with his wife, and then the plot thickens.
And that's got Judy Dench in it.
It has.
So
Kenneth
Branagh. It'd be well worth seeing. And Ian McKellen.
And the script by Ben Elton. That's also on Sunday the 26th of May, 4:30 at the Regent 3 Cinemas, Queen Street, Masterton. So you need to get to Mathscraft in the morning and then hop over to this in the have lunch and then hop over to this in the afternoon. Refreshments are served from 3:45 for a 4:30 screening. Tickets are $20, available at the Regent 3 Cinema. I don't know whether you can book, but they've got the phone number here. 377-5479 or 377-1359. So that's All Is True, the world's final act of the world's greatest playwright, Mr. Shakespeare himself.
Well worth seeing, I would think.
And we're coming to the end of another lovely day on Wairarapawatch. So next week we're going to be talking to Mr. John Booth, Mayor of Carterton.
And he's going to be telling us all about what's been happening with their plan.
Yeah, and what's happening with the surveys that have been carried out.
Yeah.
So thank you to both radio listeners and TV listeners. You've been listening to or have just missed Wairarapawatch, a weekly magazine programme about the people of the Wairarapa. Mm-hmm. So it's from Val and I, goodbye and good luck with whatever you may be doing.
Have a great weekend, folks, and be safe.
Indeed. So I'll just play a little bit of music to see us out. How's that?
There we go.
There we go.
As I sit here tonight, the jukebox plays that tune about the wild side of life. As I listen to the words you are saying, it brings memories when I was a trusting wife. It wasn't God who made honky-tonk angels, as you said in the words of your song.